Thank you, Nigel, and welcome everybody, and thank you for being part of this small but intrepid group that braved the weather this morning to come to service. I'm very happy that you're here. I'm Kat Robinson Grieder, a member of the worship team along with Susan Richards and Joanne Polster. We fill in once a month when our minister, the Reverend Dr. Althea Smith, is away. So once a month and when she's away. These services give us an opportunity to hear from guest speakers and from members of the congregation to share thoughts and things that are important to them. And this morning I will be sharing some thoughts about transition and transformation, inspired by recently serving on the transition team and also attending the UUA's General Assembly. As I often do, I start announcement time by encouraging everyone to wear name tags. It's very helpful for Newbridge to light the chalice, and as he does so, we will say together the words that are printed in your order of service. Invites us into a sacred space to reflect on where we have been and where we are going, even knowing that this particular flame will intentionally end with our ritual extinguishing. We fear not its end, for we know with brave hearts that from every ending of our lives, we are sent forth to make a new beginning. Please rise as you are willing and able to sing the doxology. In your gray hymnal, Love Will Guide Us. In your program, it says that there will be a poem next, but instead of a poem, I wanted to share with you the revised language in the UUA's bylaws for Article 2 that was just adopted at General Assembly last week. These words will replace the seven principles, and although many of us were emotionally attached to the seven principles, these new values and covenants include many of the same concepts while also deepening and expanding the language to include commitments and actions. So this is the section entitled Values and Covenant. As Unitarian Universalists, we covenant congregation to congregation and through our association to support and assist one another in our ministries. We draw from our heritages of freedom, reason, hope, and courage, building on the foundation of love. Love is the power that holds us together and is at the center of our shared values. We are accountable to one another for doing the work of living our shared values through the spiritual discipline of love. Inseparable from one another, these shared values are interdependence. We honor the interdependent web of all existence. With reverence for the great web of life and with humility, we acknowledge our place in it. We covenant to protect Earth and all beings from exploitation. We will create and nurture sustainable relationships of care and respect, mutuality and justice. We will work to repair harm and damaged relationships. Pluralism. We celebrate that all are sacred beings, diverse in culture, experience, and theology. We covenant to learn from one another in our free and responsible search for truth and meaning. We embrace our differences and commonalities with love, curiosity, and respect. Justice. We work to be diverse, multicultural, beloved communities where all thrive. We covenant to dismantle racism and all forms of systemic oppression. We support the use of inclusive democratic processes to make decisions within our congregations, our association, and society at large. Transformation. We adapt to the changing world. We covenant to collectively transform and grow spiritually and ethically. Openness to change is fundamental to our Unitarian and Universalist heritages, never complete and never perfect. Generosity. We cultivate a spirit of gratitude and hope. We covenant to freely and compassionately share our faith, presence, and resources. Our generosity connects us to one another in relationships of interdependence and mutuality. Equity. We declare that every person is inherently worthy and has the right to flourish with dignity, love, and compassion. We covenant to use our time, wisdom, attention, and money to build and sustain fully accessible and inclusive communities. Just got little, like, this is the first time that I've read all of them together like that. I just got a little chill. So now in the sanctuary, it is time when we, all of us.
One thirty, doing portrait after portrait after portrait. And I didn't even finish everyone that wanted a portrait, and I feel really badly about that. So I'm going to keep doing it for the next month. But if I stumble a little bit, that's why. Did you know you can actually paint till you bleed? I was talking to the father of the bride, and I looked down, and I had red, and I was like, that's paint. No, it's not. It's actually, I was holding my palette for 10 hours, and then I, okay. It's possible. Sounds kind of interesting. Okay, Life Doesn't Frighten Me at All, poem by Maya Angelou. Paintings by Michael Basquiat. And I will show some of the pictures because, of course, he's one of the great painters of the century. I don't think anyone's heard this for at least 6 years, so I just really have to read it today and hope that's okay. Shadows on the wall, noises down the hall. Life doesn't frighten me at all. Bad dogs barking loud. Yeah. Not our dogs, no. Big ghosts in a cloud. Life doesn't frighten me at all. Mean old mother goose, lions on the loose, they don't frighten me at all. Dragons breathing flame on my counterpane, life doesn't frighten me at all. I go boo, make them shoo, I make fun, way they run. I won't cry, so they fly, I just smile, they go wild, life doesn't frighten me at all. Tough guys fight all alone at night. Life doesn't frighten me at all. Panthers in the park, strangers in the dark. No, they don't frighten me at all. Don't show me frogs and snakes and listen for my scream. If I'm afraid at all, it's only in my dreams. I've got a magic charm that I keep up my sleeve. I can walk the ocean floor and never have to breathe. Life doesn't frighten me at all. Not at all. Not at all. Life doesn't frighten me at all.
Thank you, Leah. And I'm glad that you get to stay with us for a little while this morning. As we enter into a time of contemplation and meditation, you may remain seated for the singing of hymn number 123, Spirit of Life. Ready, Nigel?
Sorry, I don't have my order of service.
These words are by Lynn Cox. Spirit of life, ever adapting and renewing, we come together this morning with yearnings that do not match. We yearn for stability, for even one moment of feeling like we know what is going on, for the ability to predict and prepare for what is coming next. Yet we also yearn for change. We ache for a world that turns aside from racism, violence, dehumanization, and disregard for suffering. We pray for a change in the illness, grief, isolation, incarceration, and vulnerability of loved ones. We reach for connections that will remind us that we are worthy as we are, and we reach for connections that will help us to become our best selves. Hold us in the heart of both and. Cradle us in the mystery. Cherish us in the internal presence of love and encourage us on the path of growth and development. as individuals and as people, help us to become who we are called to be. Lead us to open pathways to deeper wisdom through reconciliation, self-respect, and mutual respect, compassion, owning, and making amends for our mistakes. Source of wonder, move us to express and live in gratitude for the beauty of this world, the loving people in our lives, and this day of possibility. To this we add the meditations of our hearts as we enter into a time of silence. Continue with the singing of hymn number 396. I know this rose will open, and it's very short. We're going. That's next, I think. Oh, well, it's different in the order of service. Should we? Yeah. Let's sing the hymn first, then we're going to go into joys and concerns. 4.
It's short, so we're going to sing it through 4 times. And once you get through the first one, you'll probably know the words, so you can put away your hymnal.
So now, joys and concerns. And community, help the joys become more joyful and the sorrows easier to bear. I've been thinking a lot about transitions lately. For the benefit of anyone who is visiting this morning or returning from a time away, I should tell you that our congregation is in transition. Our former settled minister, who is here this morning, Linda Simmons, retired almost a year and a half ago.
We left a year ago today.
Yeah. So it's serendipitous that you're here today. Reverend Althea Smith has been with us as a contract minister for about 9 months and will continue to be our minister for another year. Change is hard, unsettling, and it also gives us an opportunity to do some soul searching, assessments, and discernment. When there is a break in the status quo, it's a chance to wake up and look around and decide if we are on the track that we want to be on. It's an opportunity for transformation. As I was trying to figure out an entry into my topic this morning, I remembered an episode of the NPR show Radiolab that has stuck with me over the years about caterpillars and butterflies. I even have a mental image of listening to it on my car radio while driving out the Pulpis Road on my way to Quays Beach. So I looked it up online. The episode reported by Molly Webster is called Goo and You. The story of a caterpillar turning into a beautiful butterfly has been used so many times as a metaphor for transformation that it's easy to dismiss it. And yet, when you think about it, it truly is miraculous that a caterpillar, crawling along on its little legs, doing what caterpillars do, eating lots of leaves, at some point attaches itself to a branch or leaf, hangs upside down, and forms a chrysalis. Inside the chrysalis, its caterpillar body is dissolved by enzymes into goo, and then is reconstituted, and a totally different animal emerges. It's also easy to see why the transformation of an earthbound creature to a beautiful winged one has historically raised not only scientific questions, but metaphysical, mystical, and philosophical ones as well. When naturalists in the 1600s cut open a chrysalis and saw just goo, it appeared as if the caterpillar had died in the process and was resurrected as a butterfly. This led people to seeing the caterpillar as symbolic of the lowly, earthbound human form, while the transformation to a butterfly symbolized the soul's escape and ascent to heaven. I think we as individuals and as a congregation hope for transitions that result in a transformation to something better. But change is hard, and it involves work and risk. It's more comfortable to stick to the tried and true, even if it's not working so well anymore. As many of you know, I am part of the transition team. After researching options, surveying the congregation, and eliciting feedback from several group discussions, we recently gave our recommendation to the Board of Trustees about what our congregation should look for in our next minister. Our report will soon be disseminated to the congregation, so you'll all get to see it. I also attended the UUA's all-virtual General Assembly a week ago as a delegate from this congregation, along with Jan Ellsworth. I think it's fair to say that it's not only our congregation that's in transition. It's the whole denomination. Although our congregation has not traditionally been very involved with other UU churches or the association, you probably know something about the debate and controversy leading up to the changes to Article 2, the principles and purposes of the UUA's bylaws that were just adopted and that I read earlier in the service. The UUA bylaws themselves mandate that Article 2 should be revised every 15 years, yet there have been no major changes. There have been some revisions, but no major changes since the 1980s. The commission appointed to study the Article 2 and make recommendations began its work in 2020 and submitted their report in 2022. Over the last 2 years, there have been many opportunities for congregations to learn about the changes and provide input. Hundreds of amendments were proposed and many of them voted on at GA in 2023 and also this year before the final vote to adopt it was taken. Much of the debate centered around the love and attachment many people feel towards the seven principles, which is natural because they've been with us for so long and have been important in our so many of our lives. At GA last year, I learned about and grew to appreciate the ideas and values embodied in the proposed changes. But I can't say that voting to replace the seven principles with the new language was an easy decision. Ultimately, I decided to vote to adopt it, not because I loved all of it, which I hope to in time, but because ours is a living tradition. That means we prioritize continuing to evolve, to change, to adapt to the times and new information. We value and honor our past, but we don't canonize it. So our denomination is also changing and evolving. Some of the changes will have direct implications for our congregation as we navigate our own transition. We have already heard that due to the relative scarcity of ministers and the cost of the settled minister search process, small congregations of less than 125 members are not being considered for settled ministers. At the same time, the options for different types and configurations of ministry has expanded and continues to do so. At GA, Jan and I attended morning sessions with a small congregation cohort. You probably won't be surprised to hear that many of our congregation's challenges are common, such as the challenge of finding congregants to fill volunteer and leadership positions, causing burnout in those people, and potentially a feeling of exclusion and non-engagement among the others. A desire to grow the congregation, financial challenges. There was an acknowledgement that COVID changed everything in some positive and some negative ways. For example, remote and hybrid services have made it possible for more people to attend and be involved. However, the loss of child and youth attendance on Sundays has not rebounded. We learned some practical things, like a process for deciding what programs and activities should continue and which should be celebrated and let go. And we learned about some trends and strategies for engaging congregants in volunteer activities, such as focusing on clear, hands-on, and time-limited activities to increase joy and meaning while lessening the burden and time commitment. One of the most interesting and helpful things I've learned from multiple sources lately is about what people, particularly young people, are looking for from church. See if they resonate for you as well. Meaning making. An opportunity to explore and deepen spiritual beliefs and practice. Community. A sense of belonging, acceptance, and authentic connection. Justice work, a way to make a positive difference in the world. I think these things fit very well with the findings of the transition team and point to the importance of prioritizing congregational health over size. I truly believe that if we work to create the community that we want to be part of, it will naturally attract and retain new members. I invite you, as we continue our transition process, to consider what you need from a spiritual community. What needs are being met, and what additional needs would you like it to fulfill that it's not currently? And after you consider your needs, I want you to consider what you can give to the community to help fulfill those needs for yourself and others. For example, I've known for a while that I want to participate in a workshop, class, or group that will help me assess my spiritual beliefs and deepen a spiritual practice. I've also been considering rejoining the prison letter writing ministry. I know about myself that it's hard for me to do these things on my own, and I need community for support and accountability. I've already looked at some different curriculums, and I'm willing to convene and possibly facilitate an adult group. And I also have some ideas about how to fit the prison letter writing ministry into a regular social activity. I'm sure you have ideas and things as well. As far back as the 1600s, a Dutch microscopist named Jan Swammerdam showed in a dissection of a caterpillar that some structures of a butterfly, like its wings, antennae, and legs, are already formed inside the body of the caterpillar. And yet, when a chrysalis is cut open, there doesn't seem to be any sign of a caterpillar or a butterfly. We also now know through scientific experiments that at least some elements of memory carry forward from the caterpillar to the butterfly. Despite the massive transformation, there is continuity. At the end of the Radiolab episode I referenced earlier, Molly Webster says, "It's not just what of me carries forward into the future. It's like, what of my future self is in me right now?" I hope we will use this time of transition as a time to put in the hard and sometimes painful and sometimes joyful work it takes to transform ourselves. What of our future congregation is in us right now? Let's find out together. final hymn is number 300 in the gray hymnal, With Heart and Mind. Please rise as you are willing and able. Closing words are by Michelle Collins. Changes abound around us, within us, between us, in our communities, in our neighborhoods, and our beloved faith communities. Changes abound. May we each find the balance point we need as we move through our ever-changing world. The balance between the old and the new, between the known and the unknown, between the familiar and the perhaps bold and risky possibilities that may be there waiting. As Paul Stewart comes up to extinguish the chalice, please join me in saying the words that are printed in your order of service. Though we extinguish the flame that has guided us through this time together, we may in our hearts, reminding us of the transformative power of love and community until we are together again. Thank you.